Gracious God, the Father, we thank you for this another glory that you blessed us to see. And truly, you are all in all. You're all that we need, all that we desire. As the song writer wrote, as the deer pants for the water, so our soul pants, longs, and yearns after you. And we will not be satisfied with nothing less than intimate communion and fellowship with you, the living God. And now, Father, we pray that you would rend the heavens and you would manifest yourself in great power in our midst, that you might speak to the heart of that man, woman, boy, or girl that's troubled, that's perplexed, that's confused. They might know there's indeed a word from the living God. That you might open doors of opportunity for those who find themselves at a dead end. You, Lord, might speak to that sinner person who's never come to faith in Christ. And maybe today they realize that there is hope, there is salvation for their soul if they turn to you and receive Christ as a personal Savior. Use your word, Lord, as a healing agent to bring healing to the hearts, the minds, and the spirits of the people. And we'll be ever so careful to give your name the praise, honor, and the glory, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Remain standing, please, and turn with me in your Bibles to the Psalms. Take the Psalm 103, 103rd division of the Psalms. David, the great psalmster, is writing these words as he blesses the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executes righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in mercy. He will not always strive with us, nor will he keep his anger forever. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor punished us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from us. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. May the Lord's riches bless me upon his word that we sanctify the hearts and minds and spirits of God's people. May we see you. I want to speak to you this morning from that subject in that last verse that I read in your hearing, verse 14. He remembers that we are dust. He remembers that we are dust. I remember when I was a young whippersnapper, if you can mention, about 14 or 15 years of age, and ever went to the basketball court, I felt that I was the fastest gun in the West. And so it didn't matter who I had on my team, I thought we had a chance to win. So I remember one particular day, some of the old heads were in for the holiday. My little hometown, all people come in around the 4th of July, big family reunions and big gatherings. And so all the old heads came in, and us young guys like to strut our stuff before those guys were stars when we were kids. And so we were on the court, and we were choosing sides. And so I choose a couple of the old heads to be on my team. And so we got in a real, real tussle with a good friend of mine, a fellow by the name of James Kenny, maybe the best athlete I ever saw in my life. I always loved to compete with him because he was the best. And the game was tough, back and forth, back and forth. You go to 26 by one, you got to win by two. And so we got down to the end of the contest. And I felt that my teammates were loafing a bit. And so I started challenging them, said, come on guys, we got to pull this out, come on. And so one of my teammates missed the last shot. I hit the layup right there, he missed the shot. And they got the rebound and went down the court and won the game. And I was very upset about that. And I started arguing with my teammates. One old fellow, he says, wait a minute, young brother. He said, you knew when you chose us, we were a bunch of drunks. And he said, you should not expect $1 million, $1 bunch of drunks. I forgot what they were. I remember what they used to be. What they used to be was not what they were in the context. But God doesn't forget what we are. He remembers our limitation. He knows our shortcomings. He knows all about our deficiencies. He knows about our dysfunctions. He remembers that we are but dust. And remembering that we are but dust, anything that he calls us to do, he knows that he must supply the energy, the unction, the wisdom, the insight, the resources, because he knows he's dealing with dust. And so if he asks dust to go out into all the world and preach the gospel, win men and women, boys and girls to Christ, when he sends us out, then he knows I must be with them because they're nothing but dust. If he calls us to teach a Sunday school class or to sing in the choir or to serve as an usher, a deacon, a trustee, he knows that we are dust. He remembers that. And so in remembering what we are, he knows that he must supply that which we need to accomplish what he wants to do. Are y'all going to help me? He remembers that we are but dust. And I think that brought great comfort and consolation to the heart of David. David, the beloved psalmist, the one who was referred to as a man after God's own heart. David, the man of tremendous, extraordinary ability as a musician, as a writer, as a composer, and as a leader who led the nation of Israel. But David, too, was but dust. And he failed the Lord at a very critical juncture of his life. And David's heart was broken over the fact he failed God. And I believe in writing this psalm, David's heart was encouraged to know that God knew and God remembered that he was but dust. I think that's why I looked at David's heart as he's writing this psalm. He opens up by saying, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. David said the totality of my being ought to be devoted to bringing blessing to God. And we often pray and ask God to bless us. As a matter of fact, one of the most popular books now out on in the Christian community is a book by Dr. Bruce Wilkinson, The Prayer of Jabez. And in Jabez's prayer, he prays that God would bless him indeed, that God would pour out a supernatural blessing upon him, and that God would extend the boundaries of his sphere of influence. He wants to be blessed. You all want to be blessed. We all want to be blessed of the Lord. But David said we ought to turn that thing around, and we ought to also want to be a blessing to the Lord. Now I'm going to ask you a question. Do you want to be a blessing to God? Do you want your life to ascend to the throne room of God as a sweet-smelling savior and bring a smile to the face of God so that God can smile and that's one of my children down there serving me. That's one of my children singing in the choir, serving on the usher, deacon board, or the trustee. That's one of my children teaching Sunday school class. And my heart is delighted. I am blessed when I see my children engaged in service to their fellow men and women to bring glory to me. Do you want to be a blessing to God? If you want to be a blessing to God, then get involved in Christian service somewhere, somehow. Find something to put your hand to do. Because God is indeed blessed when he sees his children serving him. Amen. You want to be a blessing to God, then commit your life to living a holy life before the Lord. None of us have arrived at sinless perfection. But the Apostle Paul says, we follow after. We continue to persevere. We're trying to lay hold of that which God has laid hold of us. And so we want our lives to reflect the fact that we've come to know the Lord in a living way, in a powerful way. And the power of God is now working inside of us. So David says, bless the Lord, O my soul. And everything that is in me. That is a very, very powerful prayer. When he prays and everything that is in him be a blessing to God. All of his thoughts, his goals, his ambitions, his desires, he wants them to be a blessing to the Lord. Amen. So he says, bless the Lord, all my soul and all that is within benefits. Now reason for blessing God is not offered up in a vacuum. There are sound and solid reasons as to why we ought to want to be a blessing to God. David talks about the benefits. Now, some of you who are gainful employed, others who are seeking gainful employment, or you're trying to improve your employment opportunity, one of the questions you always ask the prospective employer is, what are the benefits? What's the package that comes along with me being in your service? When it comes to serving God, it's kind of amazing. We get this fabulous salary, but the salary doesn't require us to do any work. The salary that we get is eternal life, salvation. For Paul writes to the Romans, for the wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23. But the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. So the salary we get for serving God is eternal life. We don't work for it or earn it. God gives it to us as a salary that pays eternal dividends. But David went on to say, but there are friends' benefits that we encounter while we're still on the earth. Look at what he says. He says, don't forget his benefits. What are they, David? Who forgives all your iniquities. One of the benefits is forgiveness. One of the benefits for serving God is that we have forgiveness. Anytime we fall, very popular song out there today, that we fall but we get up. But the difference between the sinner and the saint is that when the saint falls, the saint gets up because he knows that forgiveness is available. Amen. David says one of the benefits for knowing God and serving God is forgiveness. He goes on to say, not only does he forgive all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases. But David was not a physician. But as if David had some spiritual insight who understood something about the physical body, that God has equipped us within our genes, that our bodies develop antibodies to fight off diseases. Anytime anything foreign gets into our body, the body's immune system immediately kicks in. And you don't know how many diseases that God has healed you from, and you never ever had any symptoms. Are y'all there? You never even had any symptoms that you were sick because you were exposed to the bacteria or the germ or exposed to an environment that was disease-ridden. And God, through the marvels of the human body, has healed your body. Amen. That's a blessing of the Lord. Now, I haven't been sick many days in my life. As I get older, Deacon mentioned, these silences just won't let me go. But by the grace of God, I've escaped serious illness or serious injury. And I know it's because of the good hand of God. And many of you have escaped serious illness because God has healed your body. Amen. He's healed your body of diseases. Now, I know some of you live in such a modern state that you don't believe that God can heal you. God is still in the healing there. He's still able. God can still do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or think according to the power of the Spirit of God that's inside of us. God is still in the healing business. Amen. The effectual prayers of the righteous still avails us to God. Amen. And God often will respond to the effectual, fervent, intense prayers of his people. And he will extend a hand of healing to a body that is ailing. If you get healed from any kind of disease, it's because of the good hand of God. Even the marvels of modern medicine, biomedicine, all these new medicines they've developed, it's only because of the good hand of God. Amen. Don't you know that they were just off by one little millimeter, one little micron, that those pills and stuff they put together could actually kill you? You take the simple compound sodium chloride, one atom of sodium, one atom of chloride, and put them together and make table salt. Season your food. Eat one of them by themselves, any of sodium or chloride, and both of them will kill you. And it's not properly mixed together to take you out with all of the possibilities of things that could happen when you take medication. Doctors don't know everything. Sometimes they experiment. You know that? They don't know if it's going to work or not. It didn't kill the rat. It didn't kill the mice. It didn't kill the animals in the laboratory. So they assume it won't kill you. But there's no guarantee. God is the one who heals. Anytime there's healing, it comes from the Lord. And we're to give him the praise and the thanks for the healing that we receive. James says, every good gift, every perfect gift comes down from above, from the Father of light, with whom there is no variableness, no shifting shadow, no changing. God does not change. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. The writer of Hebrews writes. One of the benefits of knowing Him, serving Him, God brings healing to your body. Not only does God bring physical healing, but He also brings spiritual healing. To the downtrodden, to the discouraged, to the depressed. And we live in a day and age, there's probably more depressed people today than ever in history. And we got more gadgets and widgets and toys and games and more things to do, but we still find ourselves in the dolls of that time and don't know why. We can't seem to get up and lift ourselves up and pick ourselves up. And sometimes it will take nothing short of the filling of the Holy Spirit to lift our tired, weary soul. David says, so to bless the Lord because He heals you from your depression. He heals you from your discouragement. And He sustains you over those difficult places of life. So he says, so to bless the Lord. Bless Him for forgiveness. Bless Him for healing. And then he goes on to say, bless Him for redemption. But look what he says in verse 4, who redeems your life from destruction. Don't you know that left ourselves, we will go headlong into destruction. Amen. And we are out of control. This is a reckless society in which we live today. Young people living reckless lives. Parents living reckless lives. Even older people living reckless lives. And as Jesus told them in His day, He said, broad is the gate, wide is the road that leads to destruction. And many be that go that way. Only God can lead us down the chosen path to lives of fruitfulness, of production, and not destruction. So David says, you're blessed the Lord because He forgives your iniquities, He heals your diseases, He redeems your life from destruction. And one of the reasons that we're so passionate about trying to reach young people and to try to build assets into their lives that will sustain them and that will encourage them so that they will not forfeit opportunities that are up ahead. So their lives will not lead down a road that ends up in destruction. Right. And only God can deliver us from destruction. Amen. But David goes on to say, you're the blessing. You're the blessing because He crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies. And He satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagle. You're the blessing, He says, because He crowns you, because He satisfies you. He renews your strength. But look at what else He says. Verse 6, the Lord executes righteousness and justice for all who oppress. He made known His ways to Moses, His acts to the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger. So David says, we bless Him for the benefits. We also bless Him for His character, because He is slow to anger. Now, some of you have extremely short fuses, and I'm glad y'all met God. God has a long fuse. That's what Peter wrote in 2 Peter 3. He says, for God is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He is slow to anger. He's long-suffering toward us. He's understanding toward us. Why? Because He remembers our frame. And He knows that we are but dust. At our very best, He knows that we are but dust. And some of you young folk ought to be helping me this morning, because maybe God will speak to your parents. And when you went out and did something crazy, God will speak to them and say, well, remember, he or she is but dust. So you want your parents to remember that you are but dust, that they might have mercy on your soul. Yeah. His character, a long-suffering, patient, an understanding God, a gracious God, He's plenteous in mercy. There's no shortage of mercy in heaven. God is not going to exhaust His mercy on me. As much of a colossal myth as I am, I can't even consume all of God's mercy. There's enough for you. Because there's plenty of room, plenty of room, plenty of good room in the Father's kingdom. Plenty of room, plenty of good room to choose your seat and sit down. And if you do, you'll be recipients of the plentiful mercy and grace of God.
Amen.
So David says we bless Him because of His benefits. We bless Him because of His character. Look at what He says. Verse 10. He has not dealt with us according to our sins. nor punished us according to our iniquities. And sometimes we get so saved and sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost that we forget what wretched sinners we were before we came to Christ. And we forget that the serpents of hell still try to crawl and rise up in our soul. And I don't know about you, but I'm glad that God does not deal with me according to my sin. There was a time when I was young, and I thought, well, this is the way you get to heaven. You do as much good as you can, and you're going to do some bad. You do some good, you do some bad. And you hope that when you get to the pearly gates, you have one more deed of goodness than you have deeds of wickedness. And some folks are living like that. So like that, he let me in or he won't, based on how good I have been. But the Bible says that the debt that we owe God, the sin debt that we owe God, is enormous. And we can never do enough good deeds to carry the sin debt. And so David says he does not deal with us according to our sins. Now somebody needs to hear that. Someone needs to know that God will not deal with you according to your sins if you will repent and receive Jesus Christ. That God will wipe your sins away. That God will grant you a judicial pardon. That God will cause you to be not guilty. He will not deal with you according to your sins. But now is the day of salvation. Now is the time. While we're in this age of grace, the dispensation where God is pouring out His Spirit upon individuals and drawing them to saving faith in Christ, now is the time to receive God's salvation. So David says, we're blessed. We're blessed because He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor does He reward us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is His mercy toward those who fear Him. David is lost for words in trying to describe the voluminous size of the mercy of God. So he just chooses the largest hyperbole that he can think of as far as the heaven is above the earth. The heavens, are far above the earth. That's how far He has removed our sins from us. That's how great His mercy toward us is. If you could fill the space between the heavens and the earth, what cannot be filled because it's from everlasting to everlasting, from vanishing point to vanishing point, from infinity to infinity. That's how large the grace and the mercy of God is. So he says, for as the heavens are above the earth, so great is His mercy toward those who fear Him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgression from us. As the Father pities His children, so the Lord pity those who fear Him. You know, coming up in June, Father's Day, we're already planning some ideas for some things to do during Father's Day. We're going to plan an event, and all the kids and all our various programs we run around the city, we're going to try to bring all those kids together and try to bring their fathers. Just have a great day of fun and frivolity and excitement. Maybe God will move in the hearts of some of those fathers. There are a lot of hurting children. A lot of hurting children because of this tension, this breach of being disconnected from the fathers. A lot of hurting children because the fathers have abandoned them or at best shamed and disgraced them. The father has been indifferent and apathetic toward them. So one of the burdens God has placed in my heart is to try to get men's hearts to warm toward the children. Amen. So that when people hear this text, think about it. At the time that David wrote this text, to say a father pitying his children, it caused the word pity to emerge in people's minds. It was a good thing. Apparently, fathers were engaged and connected to the children. So for David to say, as a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those that fear Him. And writing to the people of his day, David knew they would understand that connection. Now, y'all with me up in here? But to say those words today, to say today, as a father pities his children, there's far too many children that will say, my father has no pity for me. To say today, as a father pities his children, it does not conjure up in the minds of many of us warm affection, loving embrace, provision, and protection. So what I'm suggesting to you is that as the people of God, we must try to do something to change this picture.
Amen.
To change this picture so that when we say, as a father pities his children, people can see in their minds a picture of a father warmly embracing his children, providing for and protecting his children, loving and nurturing his children.
Amen.
That's an image that we lost, my beloved.
Yes, it is.
And so if we're going to reach this generation in some kind of way, we've got to change this image of what it means to be a father. And so when we say God is our heavenly Father, that will be something that will resonate in the hearts and minds of people. But there is a Father who pities us all. He's our heavenly Father. There is a Father who pities us all, one who will be closer than a brother or sister, and even mama. One that will never abandon us. And one who will not have to be held hostage by the Department of Health and Human Services to take care of us. But a God who will provide for us and will open up the windows of heaven if necessary and pour us out blessings that we will not have room to receive. There is a Father in heaven who pities us all and who loves us all and who wants to embrace us all and to pour his grace and mercy on us all. And I know some of you in here, that's a very tender spot in your heart. There's a very tender spot in your heart. And some of you don't even mention your father's name in conversation. The last person you will remember is your father. But I just thought about to tell you there is a Father in heaven.
Amen.
Who loves you. And he wants to father you. And provide you with that that maybe your earthly father could not, would not, or did not provide. But all of our lives, God allows us to experience enough pain and enough hurt and enough disappointment so that we are driven to him. Listen to me this morning. Don't you know if your life was just this very well written out script with no problems and with no difficulties, no hardships, no pitfalls, no potholes, you would never think about coming to God. If your life went like a well written movie play or script, but God takes the hard places, the bruises that we can carry. God takes the swords that have been driven through our hearts. And God takes those things and draw us to himself so that we might know wherever you are deficient, I can supply that. Because I can supply all of your need. Listen to me. He says, Paul wrote in Philippians, chapter 4, my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. God is capable. He is able if you and I will only let
him.
I know some of y'all doubt that. I know some of y'all question that. But your presence here today is a living testimony to the power of God. We cannot sustain ourselves. We cannot keep ourselves alive. We cannot supply everything that we need. God has been good to each and every one of you up in here. And I know some of you are raised in some hellacious situations, but it was the good hand of God that kept that situation from destroying you. The good hand of God that kept the circumstances of life from crushing you. That God has spiritual force field around you, that even though you were knocked down by the grace of God, you can still get up.
Yeah.
And God still pities you to still get up. Why? For he knows our frame, Brother Walker. He knows our frame, and he remembers that we are the dust, because he is the God that created us.
Yeah.
That gives my heart great assurance and great peace to know that the manufacturer who created me, every now and then you go out and buy some things. Now my wife is the very best at keeping receipts and keeping warranties. I mean, she got them all filed away. Stuff that we bought back when the year King Uzziah died. She still got the warranty and the receipt. Oh, still got it? Still got the warranty and the receipt. I was pretty embarrassed this morning. She had a little situation last week where she just left and she had bought it. She still had the receipt. Ordered through some mail on the outfit. Still had the receipt. Had the 1-800 number. And called the woman and told her, it broke. It should have broke like this and I wasn't replaced. And the lady said, well, ma'am, nothing lasts forever. Yes, she said, it should last as long as it lasted. And lo and behold, they said, I'm brand new. Where am I going with that? Where I'm going with that is that there are times got a back there garage. I tell you, they got a 10, 15 year warranty. They're going to be out of business before you get the stuff at your house. And so when it breaks down, it's just broke down, you just got a bunch of junk. But I stop by to tell you, the God that created you, the God that manufactured you, he got the receipt, he got the word, he knows how he made you, what he made you, how he constructed you. He knows when you need a tune-up, when you need to be calibrated. He remembers your frame. He knows that you are the dust. That's what I'm talking about. That's the God that we serve. The God that remembers our frame knows that we are the dust. And so you don't have to go around and, like, apologize. I told you about my good friend Sam Monroe. I love Sam Monroe dearly. He's about my age. He's now a roommate in college. And I was sad to hear that he has developed MS and is going through a very difficult time. But the guy had his brother's normal personality. He was just effervescent, always had a joke, always smiling. One of the toughest little guys I ever saw. 5'6", weighed about 150 pounds, played football, ran by punts, kickoffs, and played wide receiver. And was tough, what his brother told him, was tough. Sam Monroe, sometimes he would, you know, just get on folks' nerves. I don't know where he put it. He just get plumb on people's nerves. And when he got on people's nerves and people started getting on his case, he had a famous line. He would always say, well, pardon me, partner. Pardon me for living, he would say, because I fell off the hearse. I just thought I'd tell you, you don't have to go around in life asking people to excuse you for living. God knows how he made you with all the quirks, all the defects. God knows your brain, and you're with God, but he still says you have intrinsic passion and work. That's what God says. God don't make no junk. There's an old priest named Billy Joe Grandstaff was his name. I don't know if he's still living that. Remember Billy Joe? Billy Joe could preach. Billy Joe had one of his famous sermons. God don't make no junk. He said he's in the sixth grade, they were in the classroom, and the teacher had every student to get up and to introduce themselves. They came down to Billy Joe. Billy Joe said, my name is Billy Joe, and I'm good. And sit down. And the teacher said, Billy Joe, can you help us out a little bit with that introduction? He said, my name is Billy Joe because that's what my mama named. He says, I'm good because God made me. God don't make no joke. God don't make no junk. Even though it's made out of dust, it's still not junk. Don't you know that everything that is created is made out of dirt? Everything that is created is made out of the dirt of the earth. It's extracted from the earth. Men just can't reach up in the sky and grab all the stuff. They got to start on the earth and get all the metals out of the ground. The oil comes up out of the ground. The gold and the silver comes up out of the ground. It all comes up from the dirt. But God says, I have made man from the dust of the earth, and I have distinguished him from everything else that's created, because I breathed in his nostrils the breath of life, and he became a living soul. And now he has God consciousness and self-consciousness, and he's fearful and wonderfully made in my own image. Well, I wish I had time, Deacon Mitch, but I want to break this down right here. Well, one other thing I want to tell you. You have to continue one more thing. There's one more thing. Verse 19, the Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, you his angels, who excel in strength, who do his work. David got so caught up, he said, well, angels, I don't think God blessed God enough. The angels were created to worship God. They've been worshiping God ever since they were created. But David said, let me help y'all out a little bit. Y'all ought to bless him more and worship him more. Verse 21, bless the Lord, all you his hosts, you ministers of his, who do his pleasure. Bless the Lord, all his works and the places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul. I trust that that's a prayer that you'll be able to pray today. It will radiate and resonate and vibrate deep down inside of you. All the problems that might be fixed. Of all the difficulty and the hardship, all the disappointment and the hurt, I'm still, David said, will reach deep down inside of me and say, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Don't forget his benefits, for he's done great things. And the best is yet to come. Oh yeah, the best is yet to come. I told y'all before, Reverend Frederick Drake, Ike McCullough, he was wrong. When Ike said, there is no pie in the sky. There is no vine, there is vine in the sky. There is a great vine, but there is a land where the wicked sees them coming and where the weary is at grass. And every day we like something. And we'll bless God and praise Him. And some of y'all who won't talk here, you won't talk when you get to heaven. It's even going to pry your mouths open. And you're going to say, wow, what a God to save me from sin, to get me up here in heaven. And you're going to tell folks how you overcame. By the word of your testimony. By the blood of the Lamb. And even though you are the dust of the earth. You know what dust is? Dust is a little bit more than dirt. Dust is what you have left all after cleaning the dirt up. But God has taken our dust. And He's doing some incredible things. That's the God we serve. The original manufacturer who made us and created us in His own image and His own likeness, who redeemed our souls, fills us with His Holy Spirit, and gives us a place in His kingdom. If there's anything that's going to give you self-esteem, we're in the self-esteem kick here now. Everybody's problem, they got low self-esteem. So we're going to try to build people's self-esteem up. We need to take account. We need to take them to the cross. When they see what God thinks about them, the value that God has placed on their soul, that's where esteem comes from. Esteem can only be given by God. A sense of worthiness can only be given by God. And we cannot experience this worthiness that God wants us to experience apart from Him. You see, when you build people's self-esteem apart from them going to the cross of Calvary, what you get is arrogance. That's what you get. Pride. Arrogance.
True.
Haughty spirits. People don't know about self-esteem on level. Low self-esteem. They got too much self-esteem. They talk about prisoners. Now, I've got great heart compassion for prisoners. I've been working with a few guys here, so I'm not being hard on people who are ex-offenders. As I share with the guys when I went to visit them at South Central, I told them I'm not here to judge you. I did some things in my life, probably the baddest thing you've done. I just didn't get caught. Praise God.
All right. Amen.
I just didn't get caught. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
But most folks in prison, I think because they got low self-esteem. They got so much self-esteem, they thought your stuff should be their stuff. Since God is speaking to you that you need to be saved, that you don't have a relationship with God, just lift your hand right where you are. Just lift your hand. If you don't know the Lord, bless you, I see that hand. Is there another? If you're here this morning, you've never been saved, you've never received Jesus Christ as your Savior, if you'd like to do that, just stand where you are.